Judge, I want to tell you something. I want to tell you something. I've been watching you, and you're not two-faced. You treat everyone the same. That was said to me by a transgender prostitute who, before I had gotten on the bench, had insulted the court officer, fired her public defender, and yelled at the person sitting next to her, "I don't know what you're looking at. I look better than the girl you're with." Yes, she said that. But she said that to me after I said her male name low enough so that it could be picked up by the record. But I said her female name loud enough so that she could walk down the aisle towards counsel's table with dignity. You see, that is procedural justice, also known as procedural fairness at its best. I am the daughter of an African-American garbage man who was born in Harlem and spent his summers in the segregated South. Soy la hija de una peluquera dominicana. People never see that coming. And so for those of you who didn't grow up watching telenovelas, I am the daughter of a Dominican beautician who came to this country for a better life for her unborn children. In my house, my parents taught me you treat everyone you meet with dignity and respect, no matter how they look, no matter how they spoke, no matter how they dress. And unbeknownst to me, it would be the most important lesson that I carried with me to the Newark Municipal Court when I became a judge and subsequently the chief judge of that courthouse. You see, every day, and not to forget, I also, at the young age of 10, was dragged off the playground to translate for family members as they began to migrate to this country. So I know how daunting it can be for individuals, especially novices, to navigate our governmental systems. You see, every day people encounter our court systems, and it's a place that is foreign, intimidating, and it's often hostile towards them. They are annoyed about their encounters with the police. They are confused about the nature of their charges, and they're often facing consequences that may impact their finances, their relationships, and their liberty. Now, as you all know, I'm just going to share with you what some people experience when they encounter our courts. First, they are greeted by people at the door screaming orders to them, usually dressed in bulletproof vests, telling them to take off their personal items as they shuttle them through security. Take off personal items, throw away other items. Once they finally get in the courthouse, they ask different people the same question and get different answers. When they finally get to where they're supposed to go, they encounter another person at the door yelling, barking orders at them, and scolding them for violating rules that they didn't know about. Take off your hat, arms off the chairs, don't sit this way, where is your paperwork? And when they meet the court, then it really gets bad. What would you think if I told you that you could improve people's court experience, get them to comply with the court's orders, and increase compliance with the law with a simple idea? Well, that simple idea is procedural justice, again, also known as procedural fairness. And it's this concept that says that if people perceive they are treated with dignity and respect and fairly by the court, they'll obey the law. Well, that's what Harvard professor Tom Tyler found when he began to study back in the 70s why people obey the law. He found that if people perceived the justice system, if they perceived the court, if they perceived their actors as legitimate authorities to impose rules and regulations, they would follow them. His research found that if people perceived that they were treated fairly and with dignity and respect by the system, not only would they obey the laws, but they would be satisfied with the court's ruling, even when the court ruled against them. Now, procedural justice is not going to solve all of our problems. However, what I found was when I began serving as a judge, I felt like being a judge is often like having a reserved seat to a tragic reality show. that has no commercial interruptions and no season finale. When I realized that the people who came before me, when I realized that their need for help was greater than my fear of appearing vulnerable on the bench, I realized two things: that one, I could help them, and that two, in fact, I needed to help them. The good thing about procedural justice is that the principles are simple and can be implemented as quickly as tomorrow. The even better news is that it can be done for free. Okay, court managers, for free. I know you like that in your budget. The first principle of procedural justice is voice. Make sure people have an opportunity to speak, an opportunity to tell their side of the story, an opportunity to explain what they are actually asking for. Even when they're not going to be allowed to speak, sometimes in court, ma'am, I'm not going to let you speak right now. You're not represented by counsel. So I don't want you to say anything that's going to hurt your case and the prosecutor's listening. But you will have an opportunity to speak at some juncture in this process. For me, the assignment of essays has been a key way to ensure people have voice in court. I once had a young woman, 18-year-old student, high school student, who had picked up a case. The original charge was unlawful possession of a weapon. She actually had taken a knife, a butter knife, to school. It subsequently got downgraded to municipal court and became a disorderly persons offense. We were fortunate enough to have a youth court, so we were able to kind of transfer her case to our youth court and resolve it by bringing her back. And one of her, part of her sentence was to write an essay. And in her essay, she wrote, "I'm so sorry I brought this knife to school. I did not intend to hurt anyone. I'm just afraid. I'm afraid all the time. I'm afraid when I walk to school. I'm afraid when I walk home from school. I'm afraid when I'm at home. I sleep with my knife under my pillow and I barricade myself in my room." In that instance, we had failed this young person. The following day, I realized that the young woman said that she barricades herself in her bedroom at night. When I then contacted her social worker and said, "This is a problem." And what we found out was that the young woman was being molested by her mother's boyfriend. Now, in our schools, we have more police officers than we do guidance counselors. And this child did not feel safe enough. She did not feel that this police officer or the police officers that she saw on a daily basis were an authority that she could use her voice and speak to and give help to. But instead, a victim appeared as a defendant in the court, and we were actually able to help them. The next principle is neutrality. And when increasing the public's trust in the system, neutrality is paramount. It is important that the court does not say things like, "Where's my prosecutor? Where's my public defender? Where's my officer?" And this is challenging. When you work in an area, in a courtroom, in a courthouse where people come in regularly, it is important that our staff not speak to law enforcement one way, and then when the defendants or court litigants come in, they're ignored. This is about perception, the perception of fairness. And as we know, the perception of fairness begins when people enter the courthouse. We most recently, maybe 2 years ago, did a procedural justice study in the city of Newark. And I was surprised that one of the comments that were made said, "You're treated better in the court if you have a private attorney because those cases go first no matter what time the officer comes in." What I realized is that we as a court, and as judges in particular, and staff had not done a good job of explaining why that happens. In our opening statement, judges explain private attorneys' matters will be taken first. It is a policy of the judiciary, and we must follow it. However, what we haven't done is explain that the reason we take private attorney matters first is because we don't want to hold up courts across the state who are waiting on one attorney. It's the difference between informing and speaking to the court, to the defendant. And so now this person perceived that because private attorneys' cases were taken first, they were being treated more favorably. So that is something that we learned that we have to correct. The next principle is understand. It is critical that people understand the process, that they understand the consequences of this process, and that they understand what is expected of them. In the jurisdiction where I'm from, I know that many of the people who appear before me typically are poorly educated, and English is often their second language. NORC, on an average, will translate about 24 different languages annually. So I speak plain English. I like to say that legalese is the language we use to confuse. So we speak plain English in the courtroom. A prime example of this was when I was a fairly new judge, I'll say a younger judge. One of my senior judges came to me and gave me this script. He said, listen, if you see anybody who you believe has mental health issues, go to your script and ask them all these questions, and then you can order your mental health evaluation. So the first time I saw someone come out that I was pretty certain had a mental health issue, I went for my script and I started to ask my questions. Sir, do you take I couldn't even pronounce the words. Do you take psychotropic medication? Nope. Have you ever treated with a psychiatrist before? Nope. But it was clear to me that this person was suffering from mental health issues. So one day in my frustration, I decided to scrap the script and ask one question. Ma'am, do you take medication to clear your mind? Yeah, Judge, I take Halidol for my schizophrenia. I take Xanax for my anxiety. You see, once a person understood the question, they were able to give me valid information so that I could then begin to make meaningful decisions. The question works even when it doesn't. Mr. L, do you take medication to clear your mind? No, Judge, I don't take no medication to clear my mind. I take medication to stop the voices in my head, but my mind is otherwise fine. Yes, you see, what happens when people enter the courtroom and the court clerk understands that the person has a mental health issue? What happens when they know, when they can begin to tell that this person did not take their medication before they came to court, or that we're getting close to the end of the session and the person needs to now go take their medication? Judge, maybe you might want to take this person next. Or maybe you want to just give them a new court date, because we've begun to understand and speak and the people are now beginning to share information with us. And the last principle is respect, that without it, none of the others work. Now, respect is as simple as saying, good morning, ma'am. Good afternoon, sir. I actually once had a judge say to me, you call the defendant sir and ma'am? And I said, well, when I'm discourteous to someone, that doesn't say something about them, that says something about me. It's when I make eye contact, when I look a person in the eye, when they ask a question, when they come up before me, and especially when I'm sentencing them. I have started going around the country and observing courts. And I was really shocked by one court, a pretty large court system, where the judges are instructed not to make eye contact when giving adverse decisions. So you sentence someone to jail, you don't look them in the eye. You give someone a bail, you don't look them in the eye. What do they think about that justice? What do they think about that justice? If you can't look someone in the eye when you give them an adverse finding or ruling, It's also, respect is also when I say, how you doing today? And not as a greeting, but as someone who's actually interested in the response, so I actually wait for a response. There are communication studies that show that when the person's of color or a woman, judges move quickly before the answer comes. Ask a question, we move on. So being conscious of communication styles, that people may wait longer before they answer questions. And respect is definitely when I say, sir, are you having difficulty understanding the information in the paperwork? When I realize there is a literacy issue and not, you can read and write, can't you? Which just happens and happens. You see, that is what the transgender prostitute was telling me. She was telling me that she was judging me as much as I was judging her. And from the moment she saw how I was engaging other people, she had an expectation that she too would be treated with the same dignity and respect that everyone else experienced in court. And now I'm not telling you what I think, I am telling you what I've lived using procedural justice and procedural fairness to change the culture at the courthouse. Now, I started as a traffic judge, and after being there comfortably for 8 months, I got a call from my chief judge, and he says, oh, I'm moving you to part two, criminal court. Now, I need to tell you that this was not good news. And I'm gonna tell you the truth. I've just started telling the truth about this because I'm a little more comfortable with it. The only reason I went, initially when he told me I was going, I was like, oh no, not going there. No one wanted to go to this court. And he said, okay, well then, I guess I'm gonna have to move you to night court so that I can shift someone else. And I said, oh no, you can't move me to night court. I'll never get married then. Because I was convinced that I would never get married if I was stuck in night court. At least I had my priorities straight. So part two, criminal court, was your typical criminal court. It was, you know, the place, it was a court with voluminous cases. Newark Municipal Court at its height would see about 500,000 cases annually would be filed through the court. So it was the same kind of conveyor belt justice, the same folks, the low-hanging fruit, the low-level offenders, the schizophrenic homeless person, the Vietnam veteran homeless person living at Penn Station, the young person who had dropped out of high school, petty drug dealer, the drug-addicted prostitute. You know, those people doing 30 days, they're doing a life sentence 30 days at a time that come through our courts. Fortunately for us, the city of Newark decided that Newarkers deserved better. So they partnered with the Center for Court Innovation and the New Jersey Judiciary, and the help of one of your longtime NACOM members, Collins Ijoma, who was then, I don't know, is Collins here? I saw him the other day, he's around. Who then partnered with the Center for Court Innovation to create Newark Community Solutions, a community court program. Now defendants who came before the court would have an opportunity to get an alternative sentence. So judges could now tailor justice to serve the person that came before them. So a person who would typically get a jail sentence would now have an opportunity to get the community court program, which involved individual counseling sessions, group counseling sessions, as well as community service. This meant that the court now partnered with GED programs, and we would refer people to these places, and we had a staff of social workers and case managers on site. We also partnered with other organizations that did mental health evaluations. Prior to that, if defendants needed mental health evaluations from our court, we were required to send them to the county jail for 14 days to give the psychiatrist an opportunity to evaluate them. Now we have, we've partnered with organizations that actually come on site, and every Thursday or every other Thursday they come to court and do mental health evaluations. So this wonderful program, what was the problem? It was now going to be housed where? In part two, criminal court. And part two's, the attitudes there were terrible. Why was that? Part two is where you sent everyone who was being punished. Judges, the new judges went there as a part of a hazing process, as if they were in a sorority or fraternity. You sent them there to get hazed. The prosecutors and public defenders were also sent there. They felt like their 30-day rotation there was also a 30-day jail sentence. The staff that you sent there, now you guys all have these staff members, you know, those folks who have civil service, and you can't, there's not another place to shift them. And so they'd end up in part two criminal court with a large workload, with all of their challenges. So the staff knew that as soon as they got sent there, they were being punished, and they behaved that way. That if I'm being punished, I'm gonna punish everyone who comes around me. I was once told that someone in the courtroom said, referred to the defendants who came through the courtroom as the scum of the earth. And then that person had to represent them. You know, I would hear things from people when I got assigned there, like, oh, how could you work with those people? They're so nasty. You're not a social worker. You're a judge. But the reality is that as a society, we criminalize social ills. And then we send them to a court and tell the court system, do something. Apply your criminal justice approach to a social ill and get us a result. And the reality is that what we need are tools in the court so that we can address those social ills that are being sent to us. I decided that I was going to lead by example with procedural justice. And my first foray into the approach came the day that a gentleman, he looked around my father's age, came in. He was drug sick, his head was down, his body was shaking from the effects of being drug sick. He came in shackled to another person because he had been in custody. And I said to him, I asked him how long he had been addicted. He was totally caught off guard by the question. He said, I've been addicted for about 30 years. And then I asked him, do you have any children? And he said, yeah, Judge, I have a 32-year-old son. And I said, oh, so you've never had an opportunity to be a father to your son because of your addiction. And he began to cry. I said, oh goodness, the new judge is made. This is gonna be a problem. But I continued with him. I said, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna let you go home. Even though you have a number of failure to appear in courts, I'm gonna let you go home. And in 2 weeks when you come back, we're gonna get you linked to some services for your addiction. Now, as he walked out, the court officer came up to me and he shook his head because I really would upset the officers. The officers didn't, they were like, this new judge has no idea what she's doing. And I was like, that's all right, but what color is your robe? Right? Because the reality is that when you deal with people who always get jail time, how do you make jail a legitimate punishment? So I would let people would just go home. But I let this gentleman go home. And the officer said to me, ah, you're never going to see him again. And I said, okay, watch. 2 weeks later, who's sitting in the audience with a button-up shirt, shaved, haircut, and dress pants? But my guy. I just looked at the officer and said, ha-ha. When he comes up, I said, well, welcome back to court. I see you made it. And he says, Judge, I came back to court because you showed me more love than I had for myself. And I thought, my God, he heard love from the bench? Oh, I could do this all day, right? Because the reality is that when we change, then people respond differently. The court becomes a place that you can go to for assistance, like the schizophrenic 50-something-year-old homeless woman who came to court. I had been monitoring her case for months, and she was a perfect community court person. She showed up, did what she was supposed to do. And one day after I had dismissed her case, we had vacated all her fines, she had done everything that she was supposed to do, I'm on the bench and she comes in and she screams, hey, Judge, I just came back by to see how you're doing. Ooh, I realized that she was in crisis at this point. So I just said, have a seat. My court administrator gets up and goes in the back and talks to her to calm her down. She's speaking to the voices because she is in the middle of a crisis and can't get herself to the hospital. But she can get to the courthouse. Now, I need you to understand this woman's like 6'1". Maybe 250, and loud. And she's in the back of the courtroom talking. The police officers go over and talk to her. Our bailiff goes over and talks to her and calms her down. Do you want anything? And after 4 hours of coaxing by the prosecutor, public defender, the court administrator, the judge, police officers, were able to convince her to get into the ambulance that we've called that will now take her to the crisis unit so that she can get her medication. Now, I need you to understand that this is behavior that outside of any place, she would have been arrested. In fact, she could have been arrested by police officers in the court for being disorderly, because typically that's how these folks come before us. But she knew that she could come to this courthouse. One, she could get through security. In fact, the security guard at the door held her bag. And she went downstairs and changed her outfits 3 times because she said, oh my God, I'm not dressed appropriately for court. And just kept coming back to the courtroom. But everyone in that courthouse understood that this was a place that someone who has this problem can come to and is going to be treated respectfully. It is what happens when you connect people with the community again. Our defendants get reconnected with community again. like Mr. M, a 50-something-year-old gentleman who was sent to do community service. And when he comes back, I say, Mr. M, how was community service? He says, oh, Judge, it was terrible. I had to clean the park, and it was full of empty heroin envelopes. And as he's wringing his hands, he confesses, Judge, I realize that this is my fault. Because before you sent me to that park to do community service, I had never been in the park when I wasn't high. I actually use that park when I get high. And I never noticed the children in there playing. And I realized that that was my fault, that there were heroin envelopes and that children had to play in this park. And I looked at him and I said, you know, in the suburbs, children don't have to play in parks with empty heroin envelopes or dirty syringes. And I don't think the people in the suburbs love their children any more than we do. Every drug addict's head went down in that room. Who was better to teach that lesson than Mr. M? It is what happens when we meet people where they are. Like the 60-something-year-old gentleman who would come to court with corn rolls and these little gold things hanging from them. I was later informed by the social worker that he believed himself to be a pirate. And every time he came to court, he sat in the front row. Very respectful, but he sat in the front row. One day he came to court, I don't know if the bus was late, but he was late to court, and the officer escorted him to a seat in the back. He began to tussle with the police officer. As he tried to get to the front row, I think that while he sat in the front, he believed that he was navigating the ship. At that point, I waved at the officer, and the court administrator got up and moved everybody who was in the seat in the front row. Because what we understood was that for us to have a good day with this gentleman, for him to receive justice, he had to be in that seat. And if you were sitting in that day, you had to move over. That is what happens. It's what happens when the court meets people where they are. Like the 40-something-year-old chronic panhandler who comes before me, who suffers from traumatic brain injury. He was robbed years prior and received a severe beating that left him literally at the age of a 12-year-old. And after 3 years of rehabilitation, he was able to get his son back, but he can't read anymore and his speech is very slurred. One day he comes before me, and again, we had just put him through the program. He had a number of panhandling tickets. And I was so frustrated with him. I said, I don't understand why you continue to panhandle it. You're not using drugs. I know you receive a check, but you keep coming before this court with this. It's almost as if you want me to send you to jail. And he always stood before me with his head down. And on this day, he looked up and he said, Judge, I have a 12-year-old son who goes through our food stamps very quickly. And I thought, my goodness, for those of you who have teenagers who don't know how to stop eating, I thought, wow, we missed it. And so in this instance, what we were able to do, we were able to send him to one of our community food banks so that he could actually supplement the food that he had in his house. But it's also what happens, the transgender prostitute that I was talking about earlier. When she comes back to court and files a citizen's complaint against one of her neighbors for calling her a pejorative, instead of knocking her in the head, which is what she usually does, which is why she ends up in court. But she comes to court to file a citizen's complaint because she knows that in this space, there is justice for her as well. Now, these tools, again, as I said, are not miracle cures, but I believe that they get us light years closer to where we want to be. And where we want to be is a place where people come to our halls of justice and know that justice will be served and believe that they will be treated with dignity and respect. Imagine that, a simple idea. Thank you. Now, I'm going to go on with my presentation. I don't know if anybody wanted to have questions now, or I could do them later in the presentation. Okay, I'll do them later if there are any questions. Now, I came all the way from New Jersey, so I hope we have some questions or just some conversation. Can we cue the video?
Monsieur, parlez-vous français?
They want to know if you speak
French.
No, parlo francés. Yo hablo español.
Oh, español. Español. Allez me chercher le poivron.
Oh, tout de suite.
Excellent, je vous reviendrai tout à l'heure. Bien, très bien.
What are they talking about?
How would I know?
Well, they're going to send me to the guillotine.
Now, you just take your time.
Voici mon idée. Je vous parlerai, vous lui parlerez, il lui parlera et lui, il parlera à la dame. Allons-y.
Er spricht zu mir, ich spreche zu ihnen, sie sprechen zu ihm und er spricht zu ihr.
Elle va hablar a él, él me va a hablar a mí. Yo le voy a hablar a usted y usted le habla a la señora.
Ah, muy buena idea, muy buena idea.
What?
Very good idea.
What is?
Oh, the sergeant only speaks French. See, and now this other cop here, he speaks French and German.
Huh?
And this fellow, he speaks German and Spanish.
Oh.
So he's going to ask the questions and we'll translate them to you.
Oh, good.
Bueno.
Sehr gut. Bon. Et où puis cet argent?
Wo haben Sie das Geld her?
Donde tomo ese dinero?
Where do you get the money?
I got it from a man on the street, but I didn't know it was counterfeit.
Me lo dio un hombre en la calle, pero yo no sabía que era falso.
Eine Menge des Rasses gebe ich zu mir, weil ich denn nicht, was ist das Geld?
Je l'ai reçu d'un homme dans la rue et je n'ai pas su que c'est faux.
Ha! Ha!
Ha!
Ha!
Es la verdad!
Das ist wahr!
C'est vrai!
Je dois vous prévenir que le maniement de faux billets est puni par les travaux forcés en perpétuité.
Ich mache Sie darauf aufmerksam, dass das für das Verteilen von falschen Geld zu Hause steht, verlängert mit fester Arbeit.
Yo le quiero hacer saber a usted una cosa, que el que falsifica dinero va a la cárcel por trabajo forzado para toda la vida.
Aber you do not something. Now the penalty for counterfeiting is imprisonment, life imprisonment and hard labor. No.
Sie sind verrückt. Ich bin nicht mehr Geld.
Es ist in der Erde, der Vormonier.
I am innocent.
Yo soy inocente.
Ich bin unschuldig.
Je suis innocent.
Bien. Si elle rend l'argent, elle peut s'en aller.
Gut. Wenn Sie Ihre Restaurantrechnung bezahlt, kann sie gehen.
Bueno, si ella le paga de vuelta al restaurante, ella se puede ir.
Good. If you pay the restaurant bill, you can go.
Hooray!
Olé!
Well, the world!
Love you!
El dinero, aquí lo tengo yo.
You can cut. I love to show, that's one of my favorite I Love Lucy videos, but I love to show it because this is how some people experience our courts. Literally, this is how some people experience justice in this country. They don't understand, people are translating from languages, things are lost to them, and they just feel at a loss. And so using procedural justice, procedural fairness, just really brings home the idea that we, as a justice system, understand that we have an obligation to ensure that justice is dispensed in a manner that is fair and equitable, but that we all play a part in making sure that people feel that they're treated with dignity and respect. So, please talk to me. Consider a time you had to wait in a long line, you were treated disrespectfully, you were a layperson, and someone in a position of authority failed to explain something important to you, or your concerns weren't treated seriously. Please, someone share. No one has a DMV in their community? Someone? Mr. President, incoming president?
Oh, yeah.
Said yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So I also teach, so you know any movement is like hand raising to me, blinking. Tell me about a time when you had to wait long or felt you were treated disrespectfully. Share with us.
I think I would have to go back to undergrad.
and waiting in the financial aid line.
Oh, yes, the bursar's office. What was that like?
It was a long line. When I got to the front, I was told I didn't have everything I needed, although the paperwork said I had everything I needed. And so it was very frustrating to go back to get whatever I was supposed to get and couldn't find.
Okay, thank you. Someone else? Someone else? I'm going to keep... Oh, back there. Can you stand up so we can see you? Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you.
Years ago, I had an experience before I started working in a court, and I've been in courts almost 40 years, so it's been a while. But I went to a front counter trying to get some simple business transacted, and I was astonished where the frontline clerk, if you remember riding school buses in our old years, and they had the large rearview mirrors, this clerk had a large rearview mirror over her desk. When I came to the window, she would not get out of her seat.
Wow.
She would not acknowledge me. She just looked in the rearview mirror and barked, basically, and basically demanded that I do X, Y, and Z, and you know, leave the papers there, sign it, whatever it was. But when I thought that kind of disrespect stayed with me for years, and I thought in any court that I worked in, we weren't going to act like that.
Wow.
So it was a real lesson.
I've never seen or heard of anything. Anybody over here? Someone over here, please. Where do you guys have all this perfect service so I can move to that stage?
You got one.
We have a hand over here as well.
We got one back here ready.
I mean,
I'm the one in the back who's ready.
Okay.
How about standing in a line and the clerk goes to someone behind you and says, I'm going to take her first.
Ooh. Yes. Yes. Ooh. What would have made that experience better? Has she explained why she was taking? Would that have been different for you? Just, and then we'll get.
No, there was no explanation she could give. I was the only person of color in the line. Okay, and once, after waiting all that time, she reaches around me and says, I'm going to take her first.
Wow.
It wasn't pretty.
I know it's shocking, but when I was probably just coming out of high school, I had a parking ticket in the city, and I hadn't paid it, so I had to go to court. And I had never been to court before in my entire life, so I was terrified going in this room with everyone, so I immediately thought, you know, I don't know what I'm doing. I didn't understand what they were talking about. All I knew is that if I didn't come, they were going to put out a warrant. I didn't even know what a warrant was. Wow. And I remember my mother went with me and consoled me, and she was like, well, you need to go because I can't send you cigarettes and chocolate in jail, so you need to go. You know, and I remember feeling very overwhelmed by the experience, and I was literally in terror the entire time because I didn't understand the procedures of court. So it was a very... impressionable experience for me.
Wow. Anyone else?
Right here.
Right here.
So my experience was when I landed, I flew over to England to meet my husband, military.
I'm back here. Who's speaking?
Right here.
Okay, I'm sorry. There's so much light here.
My husband was in the military, and I flew over to see him in England. And nobody told me flying into Heathrow how big of an airport that is. Mm. I literally thought I had landed at the wrong airport. As you continue to walk and walk and walk, I finally get to customs and I'm looking for my husband. I'm like, where is he? But it was very scary because I was out of my element in another country.
Wow.
And he wasn't answering my questions. And he was asking what I had with me. And I was just, where's my husband? Mm-hmm. You know. So anyway, I can understand when individuals come to our court because they're out of their element. So I understand.
Absolutely. Wow.
Next. I was thinking about an experience I had while I went to jury duty. Mm-hmm. And as we were coming through security, just all the stuff that we had to take off and how unpleasant the young man was. And I said to myself, I said, not even a smile, not even good morning. I was there to serve as a juror. I wasn't the quote unquote somebody who had done anything wrong. Mm-hmm. I was there to be of service. And he was really not very nice. So mm-hmm. when I got to court, I told the judge, I said, you know, I understand that they have to be wise. However, I think they can still be nice.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Out of your element, people are being disrespectful. People in this, everybody's good to y'all? Nothing happens? I mean, the whole group of you, nobody's got anything to share with me? You see, I'm not moving off this side of the room, right? Take it for the group. Somebody, say something.
Good morning.
Oh, we have...
We got one here.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Good morning, Judge.
Good morning.
My experience was as well in the courts. I went to the courts prior to working for the courts, and I came in, and of course, anytime you go in, you want to see who's before you so that you know when your time is coming. So I noticed that there were several people before me. I go and sit into the courtroom, and of course, there are more people. But I noticed that there's a line, and everyone is talking to this person who I didn't know who that person was. But all those people who were talking to that person, even the ones who came after me, mm-hmm. were able to go before the judge, and it seems as though their outcome was good. Mm. So you're going in, you don't know who you're supposed to speak to, and I find out later on, working for the courts, everyone was trying to get a plea agreement with the prosecutor. But no one told me I was supposed to speak to him. So when I get before the judge, you know, I don't know what's supposed to happen. I didn't know that I can negotiate the fines. Mm-hmm. Everybody that came before me that had more egregious charges had less fines.
Wow.
I go up there, and it's just because I didn't pay a parking ticket for, you know, 100 years ago, and I pay more money. So the moral of the story is sometimes you have to do what they do in Rome. If you see them standing in the line to talk to someone who looks important, maybe you should stand in line and talk to that person as well.
Any more? My favorite disrespect story was in my own city. I was driving somewhere during lunch, and it was a merge, and we had an officer. I know what the undercover cars look like, but there was an officer in a tinted windowed car. And so it was a merge. So the person in front of you goes, and then it's your turn to merge. So as I attempt to merge, the officer is now cutting me off, causing me to drive into the cones. But I continue to move forward. And the officer rolls down his window and begins screaming. And I roll my window down. And in the middle of screaming, he realizes, oh, snap, that's the judge. And I don't say a word. And he's like, oh, I'm so sorry. Every time he sees me in the courthouse, he runs the other way now. And I think, I'm like, think about that. I'm just a citizen, really. And this is how you behaved towards me. And so what, like I know in traffic court, people just show up to fight about the principle of these tickets. Whether they know they're guilty, you know, I'll plead guilty, but I need to fight about how this person treated me disrespectfully. So I always hope that that's a great reminder, particularly for this particular officer who was just way out of line to just scream at someone because they merged when they were supposed to. So how would you wish you had been treated? Respectfully, with eye contact. I heard someone said when she was at Heathrow, you wish they had been answering your question. So listening and letting you speak and answering your questions. You wish that there had been instructions when you had gone to court about speaking to the prosecutor. More information, you know, you can relax. This is what's going to happen. This is the process. Things like that. Given an explanation and invited to ask questions. Do you have any questions about what I've told you? I know that in court people will nod, nod. They'll just nod, and then I'll say, well, what did I say? And they can't even repeat what it is that they've said. They're just nervous. I'm sometimes even in trying to find out if a person needs an interpreter. I'll ask them, you know, are you more comfortable in another language? We'll just get someone on language lines. So just taking my time with them is also helps alleviate some of those issues. What do we want as professionals? What do you guys want as professionals? Someone? Anyone? Somebody that's back there. What do we want as court professionals?
I think one of the things in court administration I'd like to see is that the judiciary doesn't get to pick and choose what they think procedural fairness is. Mm. They define it sometimes for themselves.
Okay.
Classic example is a judge will move his calendar in a minute when he wants to go on vacation. Is that not denying somebody access to justice?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and things like that. So how they define procedural fairness Okay. Sometimes can be a little unclear.
Okay. Some continuity. There was someone, I think, behind you. Anybody? We don't know what we want. What do we want as professionals? As people who run court houses, right, run entire systems, what do you want as professionals? No question. There's a hand back there.
I think as professionals, we want the same thing that the customers are coming in. We want to be treated respectfully and fairly. Mm-hmm. And, you know, in return, we're going to give that same respectful and fair treatment back to them. We also want consistency, mm-hmm. that when somebody is coming in, then we can give them instructions and know that it's going to be consistent across the circuit.
Well, that's what they found. They found that often when this question is asked of court professionals, the words efficiency come up, better outcomes come up for professionals. And then when asked of the people it serves, what they want is to be treated fairly. That is their main focus. The court's efficiency obviously is not their concern unless it's causing them to come back to court multiple times. But what they're really focused on is being treated fairly from the beginning of the process to the end of the process. So making sure that our goals are aligned with the people that we serve is important. And so what is procedural justice? It focuses on process, procedures, and interpersonal treatment of people who come before us. And that includes not just defendants, but complaining witnesses, family members who tend to come with them as well, or any other individual who may visit our court or come to our court as well. And that's contrasted by distributive justice, which is focusing solely on the win and lose. Now, I'm not saying that, and procedural justice is not saying people don't care whether they win or lose. That is not the case. People know that somebody's got to win and someone has to lose. It's whether or not they accept. How they accept whether they win or lose is based on the process, whether they perceive that the process was fair. The judge heard my side of the story. Even if the judge got it wrong in the end, at least they gave me an opportunity to speak and considered that when they were making their decisions. Why do people obey court orders? They accept decisions when they believe they're treated with dignity and respect. When they understand the process, like when this young lady went to the court and got this fine, she probably would have been more willing to accept the fines that she received to this day had she felt that she understood the process, that she had an opportunity to speak to someone about reducing these fines before she got to the judge. Also, that you have a voice, an opportunity to be heard and to speak, and that the process appears neutral. I mean, and neutrality is a funny one because we in ourselves are like, oh, I'm not being biased. But what does it look like? Again, when people come into the courtroom and we only treat the people that we're comfortable with in the courthouse a particular way, how does it feel? How does it feel to the people who are not receiving that type of treatment? Most people, of course, like to win. Procedural justice assumes that They know they can't always win, but they'll accept this process if they understand that they were treated fairly. Procedural justice is a primary factor in their willingness. So we look at favorable outcome and the willingness to accept it. Let's go to this next one. Let me get through some of this. And so what are some of the benefits of procedural justice? Fewer violations, revocations, warrants, and returns, compliance with the law, which is really what we want. Smaller dockets. How many people here want smaller dockets? And reducing costs and resource savings. For me, I knew that this thing that I was doing was working. When I initially got to this court, daily I would have 50, no less than 50 warrants that I would have to sign. I hated that part of my job because, you know, you're in court, you're trying to get done, and at the end you have all these warrants you have to issue. But it also means that you told someone to do something and they didn't do it, right? And so now you have these 50 warrants that have to be processed. As I began to explain the consequences of not coming to court, because again, procedural justice is not, oh, I'm just being so nice and sweet to you. It's about explaining the process so people understand consequences so that they're going to be held accountable. I began to explain, I'm going to let you go home today. You have an ROR. If you don't come back to court, you will receive a bench warrant. It's going to be a pretty high bench warrant, and I'm going to tell you what it is. And when you come back, I don't want to hear the excuse of why you didn't come. Like, if you get picked up, if you get a ride from the police department here, I'm not interested in the excuse. If you miss your court day and come back the next day or submit a letter, then I'm interested in having a conversation about that. People understood that there was a consequence for not coming back to court. I got my bench warrants down to 10 or less. Proof that this was working was I started to share this court with another judge, and she would work Mondays and Fridays. And all of a sudden, I noticed that on the days that I worked, when she would schedule cases, my bench warrants went up to 25. I was like, hold on. 25, this is a problem. We've gotten these down to 10. So I decided that I was going to sit in her court and observe what she was doing. And I noticed she'd sit in the court, and she'd give somebody a new court date, and she would release them. And then she would say stuff to them like, well, what do we have to do to make sure you come back to court? And I was like, oh, no. They don't understand that there's a consequence for not coming back to court. And so they don't come back to court. So we began to work on it, and we got them back down to 10. But I told the judge I was going to give her all my warrants to do if she didn't figure it out. Our legitimacy is not assumed by many who come before us. This is a very important lesson that I like to share with judges and people in uniform. People don't respect us because we sit high and because we wear a uniform. They have to believe that we are a legitimate authority, and they assume that based on how we treat them. And they tell us that. Legitimacy and race, perceived court performance rated as excellent or good, within white populations 59%, Hispanic 47%, Black African American 31%. This was done through a survey that was done at courts in New York. What court professionals influence perception of fairness, judges. Okay, examples from the field, and I'll go through these very quickly. What do you think when you go to this courthouse? These are real, no one created them just for the slides. Anybody, somebody tell me, what do you think when you show up to this courthouse? And you don't have to, we'll say snitch, right? That's what the young people say. This is, if you got something like this going on at your courthouse, just go back and fix it. What do you think? Somebody say something. What do you think when you see this? Somebody, say it again. The people coming are stupid. The people coming to the court. So you're receiving the benefit. You believe that they think you would believe you're stupid. Anybody else? Chaos. I would think that this courthouse is chaotic. Chaotic. I have to tell you that when I became chief judge, the first thing I did was walk around the courthouse and rip signs. People did that all the time. I don't know why my employees did that. They would just put a sign up on the wall with tape. What are you doing? What is that? Print your name. Look at that. Sign in and be seated until called.
The printed one says sign in. So already they're getting mixed.
messages walking into the building. One's telling you to sign in, and then the one that the kindergartner wrote says print.
Absolutely. But it's disrespectful for the people coming into the courthouse. Oh, now I want you to see to the, it would be your left. Yeah, your left. No, you're right. Do you see those people on the side? The wanted sign. Another fight that I had at the courthouse. I had gotten so accustomed, when you walk outside of the North Municipal Court, there's a ramp. Everyone has to use the ramp. There was a huge wanted poster because on the top floor, the police department has their warrant squad. They would scrawl across the faces, gotcha. You would see people, sometimes you'd see people in the courthouse who were on the poster, right? Because they don't change the poster because they've picked up a person. And after we did a procedural justice, someone was like, it's very disrespectful to have that poster where it is. So I had the poster removed. It was a fight with the police department about where to place this sign. And I just didn't feel that it was appropriate that you were coming to the courthouse, which is a neutral place, and the first thing you see is this. You can have it on the police floor or in other places, but not right there. And so this was interesting to me that I hadn't even thought about the fact that this poster was up there until someone had really mentioned. I thought, wow, it's probably not best suited right there in the courthouse. Okay, what about this side? Silence is required when the court is in session. No crying children. How do you parents feel? Good, bad? What is this saying? So we kind of get it. You know, you don't want children crying in the courtroom, but it makes you feel like children aren't welcome. Now, some of you should feel bad because I know some of us still have this in the courthouse. And is this useful? It is not. It doesn't, I mean, it's not even in alphabetical order. You can't really see it. You can't really tell. This is a sign that they used in Red Hook. As you come into the courthouse and right before the courtrooms, you tell everybody the rules so that they can follow them as they're coming in. Cashier and court clerk. We want people to pay. Let's make it clear. I actually, our lines are so long by the cashiers that I actually, we did an arts exhibit. We were a part of the city's art crawl, and we put our art exhibit by the side of the cashier and clerk's office so people could be entertained by that and not leave with their money in their pocket because our lines were so long. Here's another one. Questions. Our court officers are happy to help. This is a great sign to have because, one, it puts the officers on notice that they should be helping the public, and it also tells the public that they can ask officers and that we are here to help. Children's room, for those of us who have been able to figure out how to have child services at the courthouse. Some judges have welcomes in the courtroom, so you just have all the information there. And sometimes the court administrators also make an announcement. The police makes an announcement before the judges come out. Welcome to the Arizona court system. So they have this welcome and tells you all the things we can and cannot do. A pledge of fairness is a good idea. Also, if we're looking to hire people, include it in your job postings. This philosophy of procedural fairness. This was an example of forms that had been changed as well for a juvenile court. I have about a minute left. Anyone have any questions, any comments? No? Well, thank you very much.